Good evening. Thank you all for being out this evening to be a part of the press conference that Councilmember Wendell Young has called, along with other community leaders. I'd like to introduce to you Councilmember Wendell Young, who doesn't need an introduction.
Ladies and gentlemen, I'm Councilmember Wendell Young. I certainly want to thank you for being here this evening. I also want to make certain that I especially thank Pastor Baines. He's the pastor of Southern Baptist Church and will allow us to use this fellowship hall for our meeting tonight. And I call this press conference this evening to address the fire of Chief Jeffrey Blackwell. Recent emails uncovered by the media between Mayor Rahm Emanuel of Chicago and Mayor John Crowley calling to question the facts that led to the police chief's firing. As a result of this new information and conflicting emails and communication with Mayor Crowley and others, I'll be introducing a motion calling for a special investigation into the firing of Police Chief Jeffrey Blackwell. I'm joined this evening by several community leaders and other elected officials who support the call for the special investigation into the police chief's firing. I will return after their remarks and provide more detail on the motion. I will also, after their remarks, talk to you about my personal challenge to Mayor John Cranley. Now I'd like to turn the floor over to former mayor of the city of Cincinnati and the head of the Black Agenda, Dwight Tillery.
Thank you and good evening, everyone. Thank you, Councilman Young, for inviting the Black Agenda and other community leaders to participate in this most important press conference of this year. I want to commend you and Councilmember Yvette Simpson for taking the position that you did last year regarding the firing of former Chief Jeffrey Blackwell. The Black Agenda agrees with your stance then and now. We support the investigation as to whether the mayor was involved in the dismissal of Chief Blackwell. There are many, especially in the Black community, who believe that he did. The mayor says this was Blackwell's decision, not his. Therefore, we think the public is entitled to know what happened and not simply have to take the mayor's word. This recent presidential election was about truthfulness, trust, and transparency. The public, more than anything, wanted to know the truth about the presidential candidates, whether it was about Hillary's email or Trump's tax returns. The public should be able to trust the statements of their elected officials. At the center of this controversy is whether the mayor had any involvement in Blackwell's dismissal and therefore violating the city charter. The recent emails that surfaced between Mayor Crowley and Mayor Emanuel of Chicago, without question, implicate the mayor at the highest level of the ouster of Chief Blackwell, notwithstanding his repeated denials. Crowley's emails started off by saying, and I quote, "I inherited a bad chief," end of quote. Crowley said that for 20 months, recognizing the volatility of firing a Black police chief, the support Blackwell had from the Black community and the Sentinels, Crowley goes on to say, and I quote, "We waited, and then we got the Sentinels on board, so," quote, "we fired him," end of quote. For those of us who are having a problem with the meaning of the word "we," here's what the dictionary says. It is used by a speaker to include himself and others. We waited. We fired him. The mayor was indeed involved in the planning of the dismissal of the police chief. And he has been planning his removal from the day he took office. He keep in mind, the chief had served less than 2 years. 20 months is what the mayor said. So during the first 6 months of Blackwell's tenure, I had lunch with him. We became friends. The chief told me that he had tried to have several meetings with Cranley, but couldn't get one. But he said that Cranley was meeting with his subordinates, such as Assistant Chief Whalen, and felt that the mayor wasn't supportive of him. I said to the chief, let me talk to the mayor. So when I spoke to the mayor about this, he said the chief was paranoid. Last September, the city manager, Scotty Johnson, and now Chief Isaac appeared before the city council to announce the dismissal of Chief Blackwell. They rolled out an elaborate report as to why Blackwell was to be fired. This act alone deserves close scrutiny. First, the manager reports to the mayor. All department heads report to the manager and serve at the pleasure of the city manager. The manager can fire department head directors for any reason other than those that are protected by federal law. Here are the questions we must consider this evening. The manager could have called the chief in and fired him. Why didn't he? Secondly, why did the manager appear before city council to lay out his reason for firing Blackwell? And lastly, why was Blackwell's subordinates testifying against the chief before the city council since Black presented this detailed report? Never in the history of city government has this type of firing has ever occurred. No other police chief has ever been fired. Why was this show put on before the city council? Read the email. The answer is clear. Because Cranley wanted the public to believe that he had nothing to do with the dismissal because he did not want the wrath of the Black community. He said this in his email. Just read it. So Cranley had three black men deliver the reason for Blackwell's dismissal publicly. Somehow the city manager just shows up at a regular council meeting and fires an extremely high profile and race sensitive position as police chief, and the mayor doesn't have any involvement in it, and the manager reports to the mayor.
Alright, we done.
But can the mayor have it both ways?
Nope.
First, Cranley says he supported the firing of the chief, but then he had nothing to do with it. I understand he repeated that today. Cranley puts it all on the city manager for the firing of Chief Blackwell. In a recent interview about these emails, Cranley said when responding to an explanation about his participation, and I quote, "The bottom line is, this is my administration." This is Cranley now. "When the city does stuff, I view it as ours. So why isn't the actions of your only report, the city manager, firing the Blackwell, viewed as ours rather than as Black's?" In conclusion, when I was mayor, we fired the city manager. We had 6 votes reflecting gender, race, and party affiliation. The Cincinnati Inquirer put the entire blame on me as mayor, although it took more than my vote to to remove the manager. The paper, the Inquirer, said as mayor, the buck stopped with me. Mayor Cranley, you said this is your administration. So take responsibility for the firing of Chief Blackwell.
Our next speaker is supposed to be Councilmember Charlie Windmer. Has anybody seen Charlie? Thank you, Mr. Winter. Thank you, Mr. Young, and certainly we thank Mr. Tillery for laying the foundation of why we're here tonight. Last year, on the very day that former police chief Jeffrey Blackwell was fired, the National Action Network had planned to do a rally of support. A rally of support on the steps of City Hall. Many were going together that day to simply say, we stand with police chief Jeffrey Blackwell. We support police chief Jeffrey Blackwell. Before we could get there, before our rally could begin, I got a phone call stating Chief Blackwell has been dismissed. Chief Blackwell has been fired. Later that day, I did have some meetings, and I was informed by some people of some things that had happened, some things going on, some things internally with the police department, and we listened and we wondered, what's really going on here? We were informed that Mayor Cranley had nothing to do with this. This was administrative. It was done by the city manager with the agreement of others in the police department. With that, we tend to quiet down, just wondering what in the world has happened. With the release of emails last week, it appears that the story is that Mayor Cranley positioned blacks against blacks. It appears that he's saying that he waited until he could get some black people to be on his side and therefore use black people to calm black people down. And some of us have an issue with that. We only want the truth. Any person can take any position they want to take, but it is imperative that we all hear and that we all know the truth. It makes me feel some kind of way to think that someone would position somebody just to calm me down. Don't try to calm me down. Just tell me the truth. As president of the Greater Cincinnati Chapter of the National Action Network, that's why we're standing with Councilman Wendell Young. That's why we're standing with Councilwoman Yvette Simpson. That's why we're standing with others. We're standing united together saying, what is the truth? What really happened? We don't want to feel like we were just kind of slapped. We don't want to feel like this was the plan all the time. But there was a wait until certain blacks got in certain places to make the plan come forward. What is the truth of the situation? It's not about taking this side or that side. We want to stand on the side of truth and let the truth speak for itself. Thank you very much. Okay, my orders just disappeared. So, Next speaker is the president of the NAACP, Robert Richardson.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Robert Richardson, and I'm president of the Cincinnati branch of the NAACP. And I'm here this evening in solidarity with Dwight Tillery of the Cincinnati Black Agenda, Bishop Bobby Hilton, president of the National Action Network, city council member Yvette Simpson, and all of you who are here of Black Matter. I want to thank Councilwoman Wendell Young for calling this press conference. There's nothing more important for the safety of Cincinnati than to ensure that the police and the community have a strong relationship. It's highly problematic that the mayor would use manipulation around such an important issue and in the process disparage the Black community. Many of us have said over and over that the Black community is often taken for granted. Now I can add disrespect. This of these emails confirms what many of us have suspected all along, and most likely there's much more that is yet to be revealed. Now that the Crowley charade has been exposed, it is clear Mayor Crowley had no intention of Chief Blackwell ever succeeding. Mainly because he wasn't allowed to choose his own. It now begs the question, did Crowley enlist the help of the FOP when they scheduled a vote of no confidence? Did he commission a damning report to support his effort to undermine Chief Blackwell? Did he give the chief unrealistic goals to set him up for failure by directing Chief Blackwell to come up with a 90-day plan to fight crime and gave him less than a week to complete it? I'm sure Freddie will still use the lame narrative that it was the city manager's doing and he had nothing to do with it. We all know he never wanted Chief Blackwell simply because he, quote unquote, inherited him. Those few emails provide just a glimpse into Crowley's effort to rid the chief who happened to be Black. A glimpse of his dismissive attitude towards the community and his opinion of how easy it was to orchestrate to get the desired result and his confidence in things blowing over after 48 hours. John Crowley consistently exhibits a pattern and practice of acting in a unilateral and arbitrary manner without regard to transparency when doing the public's business. Once exposed, he'll apologize and expect the citizens and the community, us, to forget it and move on. And now how strange is it that shortly after these emails were exposed, the terms of a settlement is revealed. The mayor said he knew, but the taxpayers didn't know. Today, the mayor had a preemptive press conference earlier this afternoon, and he's doing it again. He said he had nothing to do with it. He said it was the city manager who fired him, and he still expects for us to believe him. I want to say to you here tonight, we've been called out as a community. We have to show folks what happened after 48 hours. After 100 days, after 300 days, if we don't, we'll keep getting what we already got. And before I close, I want to just say I was there when Bishop Hilton with the National Action Network. We were scheduled to have a rally, and we were going to be able to present our feelings to council and hopefully persuade them not to fire the chief. And they disrespected the whole community and everybody else by the time they knew we were supposed to be there. They fired the chief 2 hours early. It's like, to me, I'll say the same thing I said then. He said, well, we're going to fire him, we're going to do what we want to, and you can't do nothing about it. And so they went ahead and did it. But we're going to have to show them that we can do something about it.
not disrespecting your microphone, but it keeps falling down. But does it still pick up if it's laying down? Okay. Our next speaker was not scheduled to speak, but he's here. And he's always stood with me my entire time on council. He's been a very vocal supporter of all Cincinnatians. And I hope you'll bear with me while I ask Council Member Christopher Seelbach to come up to the podium.
Thank you all. This is really an impressive turnout. I think it shows one thing. First of all, I'm here to stand with you all. I stand with you all as a community. I stand with you all as a community that feels like you're not getting a fair shake, and we have to do something about it. But what I think is the most clear is that our eyes are open and our minds are clear. We know who John Cranley really is. John Cranley is for John Cranley. And we need a mayor who are people of the city of Richmond. So, with our eyes open and with our minds clear, we have to go into this new year very clear who this mayor is, who he is fighting for every day himself, and make sure that we elect a mayor 2017 that is going to fight for us and our values. That's all I got to say. Thank you.
Our next speaker, council member, councilwoman, whichever you prefer, Yvette Simpson.
Good evening, everyone.
Good evening.
You know, I've been in long reflection over the last week about these emails, and I've prayed a lot. And anybody who knows me knows I've sang a couple hymns, and I've even thrown up a couple Hail Marys. I want to make sure that a lot of folks here have said, I think, the substance of why we're all here today. And so I just want to envelope it into two things. Everybody knows my spirit and how I operate, and it's two. One is people. Respect and love people. And these emails shuddered me because there was no people in this process. There was no respect. There was no respect for the people who were supporting Chief Blackwell, the community. They didn't even get a chance to get heard in this process. And that's what myself and my fellow colleagues were fighting for during the termination. That didn't happen. There was no respect for the man who gave up his life in Columbus and came to Cincinnati just to do a good job and came and loved and embraced this community, met with disrespect. There was no respect for the process. There was no respect for the sentinels. The idea that you would say in an email, keep black cops close, not because they're valuable, not because they're on the front line, not because they protect and serve, not because they deserve to be heard and treated fairly, because you need them. When you fire a black chief, that's not respect. It's not respect. And so I want us to get back to the fact that our leaders should care about and respect people first. And what we saw is a leader who uses people as pawns in a complicated chess game to accomplish his objective. In the meantime, our community over 2 years, our police department, our most important, our public safety, was in the balance, stalled, 90-day plans, make sure you get the plan done in a week. Meanwhile, our city is in shambles. How dare you? Playing a political game in our safety is in the balance. Let me tell you some facts. Crime was not up when Chief Blackwell got here. In fact, it was the lowest it had been in his first year when he was supported. Check the record. It didn't start to go up until the discord that comes with not having the support you need to run a department comes into play. How do you expect someone to do a job when their boss doesn't support that? When they're being pitted against their own subordinates? When they're being undermined by the leadership of the city and by the people who are supposed to work with and for them. Yeah. I will repeat what we said before. Undermined. Can you imagine what would have happened if this chief came in right away as an outsider and met with our babies and loved our community and was visible, helped us through the first issue around tasing, helped us get through that, was in the community every single day, that he had the support he deserved. This process. The idea that we are the people who make laws and we don't have to obey them is ludicrous. We make the law. We should have to follow it. And you cannot convince me that the charter was not violated here. There is no need. And to say it was a city manager's responsibility, I respect that is not what we've seen from this mayor. Let's be very clear. We've seen it in many cases, interference with independent departments and agencies, interference with the union process. There is one thing that has been very clear. If this mayor wants something done, it gets done. And if you get in the way, you're gonna get mauled over. Let's be very clear about that. And that's not respectful, and that's not following process. And so I stand with my colleagues in investigating this. Because the reality is that we have a council manager form of government. The council wasn't informed of the termination, was not even informed of the settlement, but the manager works for us. The mayor, though, was informed of the termination and was informed of the settlement. That is not what the charter intends, and at the very least, and we can't respect people, let's respect the very law that we're all supposed to govern by. To demand answers to the questions. And this didn't come about because of anything that myself or Council Young or even Councilmember Young or Councilmember Silva had anything to do with. It was funny watching the conference this morning. My name and Mr. Young's name was mentioned at least 7 times. I didn't write the email. I didn't release the email. Neither one of us did that. So why is it our fault? It's not. The reality is we as leaders are supposed to reflect the concerns of the community that we serve. And that's exactly what we are doing because we respect people and we respect process, and that's what leadership is.
All right. Thank you.
I am told that someone who was not here earlier is here now. I should have known. This guy loves to make an entrance. Ladies and gentlemen, Councilmember Charlie Munger.
I really did not know I was on the program until this evening, but nevertheless, I'm here. I've got to meet with my wife for 36 years, and she's going through breast cancer recovery, and I ask each and every one of you all to pray for her and pray for us. I really didn't prepare any remarks, but I guess the best thing to do is to always speak your heart. I'm quite emotional about this whole thing, and the mayor and the city manager, the media, they know how I really felt about former police chief. I recall when the city manager called a meeting before city council, and I've never seen in the history of this city where a city employee was dehumanized and devalued. Somewhere we have lost our sanity or civility. No one deserves to have been treated the way the police chief was treated, regardless whether he was black or white. And you know what, as I said on the station today, I don't give a rat's ass what anybody thinks about how I feel about we and they came and got him that day, and he was embarrassed. They took his gun, they took his badge, and then they escorted him out, and I was told that he didn't even have a ride until somebody had to carry him somewhere. No one deserves to be treated like that at all. Today on accountability. And I recall when they accused Zola Stewart, Sam Malone, and myself of stealing money at MSD. And some of my colleagues, they did not treat me the way I'm getting ready to treat them now. And when they were calling for investigations and special prosecutors, as a matter of fact, I even willing to sign a motion right now for those who would like to investigate me, because I don't go around doing illegal and wrong. So if it was good for you to investigate Charlie Winburn, it is good for you to look at everybody else. So if they bring me a motion to take a look at the mayor, if it's true about what he said about the emails, then I think that's important. But I think it's beyond the emails. I think we got to look at, are we honoring the charter of the city of Cincinnati? Now, I happen not to be a charter right, but when I took my oath of office, I said that I would support the charter. Amen. So I'm calling for transparency tonight. I'm calling for us to be more humane, to have passion, civility, and really to be the leaders that we all have been called to be. I am your servant. I am here to serve you, not the other way around. I am a servant leader, and as a servant leader, we have a responsibility to you. And I think, as I conclude and recapitulate, I think that there are some things that we cannot do in the name of saving taxpayer dollars, and that's mistreating a human being. None of these same people who fired the city manager would like to be fired that way. No one should be fired that way at all, because look at the stress. They didn't take in consideration his wife, his children, their family. But in the name of good government and in the name of protecting taxpayers' dollars, they never sent us to City Hall to be mad at other folk and do others in and hurt other people and step on people and lie on folk. That's not what we have been called to do as a servant leader. We are greater than that. We are greater than that. In all of us lies the opportunity to serve. Research it on your own. 86% of all major illnesses in a Stanford study that I was listening to a tape the other day is due to stress. Whether you got cancer or high blood pressure or facing separation or divorce or having problems with your children. And I feel for the former police chief because I know the stress that he had to go to. Through. And I know the stress, even my wife, her cancer is due to the stress of life. Because you can always trace your illnesses back to major crises that you've had in your life. And this was a major crisis for a man to be ridiculed and publicly hurt and stabbed and undermined. It had to have an impact on him, and I believe that stress caused the massive stroke that he had. So I stand today, and I'm afraid of no man. I'm not afraid of a man, woman, of the press, of the media, because I serve a God. I'm
program together, if you saw the press release, you saw that we indicated that the Blackwell family would be here. For reasons that I cannot go into, they are not here. However, I am told that I think it's Jeff Blackwell himself would like to speak to us via telephone. My hope is that this will work. Iris Rowling, who's been very much in touch with the family, is coming forward now, I hope. And if it works on these devices, we'll get an opportunity to actually hear from former Chief Blackwell himself. So she's coming up, hoping the technology works, and here we go.
All right, so you're talking to a bunch of your supporters in Cincinnati and the media, and of course, NAN, the Black Agenda, and Councilman Wendell Young, Yvette, the NAACP, and Chris Silbach. So can you all hear him? Go ahead, Jeffrey, speak.
Yes, I just want to say that I truly appreciate all of the support being shown for me tonight. I wish I could be there with you all. And I want you all to keep pushing for the truth. It's there, and I think you guys know what it is. And I want you to keep pushing for the truth to come out.
All right, Chief, is there anything else? Jeff?
Not at this time.
Okay.
Other than, I owe you all a real big hug, so when I can help you enough to get back to Cincinnati,
I'm going to give you all a big hug. I want to thank Iris for that. And our prayers continue for the speedy recovery of former Chief Blackwell. Ladies and gentlemen, I called this press conference today because I am not just an elected official in the city of Cincinnati. I'm a guy who spent his entire life in this city. I grew up in this very community. I sold newspapers as a child at the corner of Rockdale Red River. Went to South Avondale School, and Samuel Locke was now torn down. When I came home from the Air Force, I walked the beat in this very community. I fought wars on this street to keep this community safe. And when I finally got the opportunity to become a Cincinnati City Council member, I thoroughly believed that even if I served with people I did not philosophically agree with, that we would share in common the need to faithfully serve the people of the city of Cincinnati. I am greatly distressed at the treatment of Chief Blackwell. And I was very angry when we sat through that council session and we couldn't do anything to stop that train from rolling. And it appeared that that was pretty much going to be the end of it. But you know God moves in His Spirit. How could we ever know that a man who thinks he's a puppet master, that a man who thinks he is above the chart, that a man who thinks that the city council works for him, that a man who thinks he can do anything he wants to anybody and never have an answer for it, how could we possibly know that he would give us what we need to find the truth in a bunch of people. Ladies and gentlemen, I saw the mayor's press conference that was held earlier today. And over again, I got angry. Because here he is again, still trying to manipulate us. Still trying to turn us against each other. You know me. Can he make you believe that I would ever say or do anything against the people of this city? And then he has the temerity to say that we called this press conference so that we could make political hay out of his stupidity. He accused us of standing with someone that he reviewed, that he believed to be inept, that he believed didn't know how to run a police department, that he believed berated his employees. The nerve of us to stand with that person and not city employees. I'm here tonight, ladies and gentlemen, to set that record straight. I will not stand with anyone who does not respect the people of the city of Cincinnati. I will not. I will not stand with anyone who would pit people against each other, especially black people in this city. Oh, we've seen this game played before. We all have. We know about divide and conquer. We know how that works. Well, you took it away from me. But I was going down that road because I read those emails. What he basically said to Ron LeMond is, I know how to handle black people. Here's how you do it. Here's how you do it. He wrote his own Willie Lynch letter. Well, I watched that press conference. Let me tell you what I did not see. I did not see him directly address the emails. I did not see him take responsibility for what he said. I did not see him talk about whether he violated the charter. That didn't come up. Here's what you have to understand. When you can't deal with the truth, you have to deflect. You have to get people thinking about something else. So let's get them thinking about how much money Jeffrey Blackwell got. Let's talk about that. Let's talk about somebody else's political motives. Let's talk about that. Let's talk about how it was the city manager who did it, not me. Let's talk about that. Let's get the black police chief up and don't let him say a word until I say to you, only answer that question. Let's talk about that. Ladies and gentlemen, this city, we deserve better than that. We deserve better than that. I don't mind being accused of doing political things. I'm a politician.
All right.
That's what I do. But I object when you try to make politician a dirty word. There's nothing dirty about what I do. There's nothing dirty about the way I serve. There's nothing dirty about what I believe. Oh, I might not get it right today, but I'll be back tomorrow and I'll get it right then. Ladies and gentlemen, serving this community is the highest calling I can think of.
Yeah, thank you.
I will not let a Donald Trump wannabe dirty. And so yes, I am calling for an investigation of the activities of Mayor Cranley around the firing of Chief Blackwell.
Yeah.
To also take a look at whether the alleged actions of Mayor Cranley violate the city charter. Yes, I'm asking for that. And I try not to get angry. Anybody who knows me knows I'm a peaceful man. But there are times to just try yourself. So here's what I've got to say. Mayor Cranley, for whatever the reasons are, seems to believe that none of us have the ability to see beyond him. He talks to us in a press conference. He'll talk to us in the news release. It doesn't come to you. So here's what I have to say. Mayor Cranley, if you believe so strongly in all the things you say, if you really believe that you should not be responsible for those emails, and I happen to think you should be, if you really want us to believe that Harry Black fired the chief of police all by himself, and I don't believe that. And if you want us to believe that the black men, you sat up in front of us at city council and then hid behind as though you didn't know what they were going to say. If you want us to believe that's the truth, I got to tell you, I don't believe that. But I'll give you an opportunity. Come and debate me in the neighborhood about that. So, ladies and gentlemen, that's how I'd like to end this meeting tonight. I want you to know I called the meeting, but I want you to know I don't stand alone. I love you so much. I want you to know that I called the meeting. I don't believe they stand alone. And ladies and gentlemen, we're going to have good government in this city, one way or another. We will not.